This video is rated G, not X, and we need to know that because we... Wouldn't you know it, I made the opening scene on the coldest day of the fall so far this year in Florida. 37 degrees Fahrenheit. The things I do for you. You will read in books and hear that you can eat insects. And you can. They can not only be nutritious, but also tasty. In fact, some North American Indians would dig a hole in a field and then put wood in it, and then form a large circle around the hole and drive the insects into the hole, light the fire, and then eat the cooked insects. They also did things such as force feeding earthworms some food and then drying them for winter use, and then also fermenting or drying fish eggs for winter use. But back to insects. Such references about insects almost always leave off one important fact. If possible, you should know what the insect has been eating. Many insects and reptiles can store toxins in the body, making them toxic. In fact, touching the poison dart frog can be fatal to humans, which does make you wonder how they caught and used it. I mean, I can hear them say, okay, I caught the frog last time, now it's your turn. Here in Florida, we have a frog from Cuba whose skin is painful and irritating to mucous membranes, at least of humans and most mammals. And there is at least one report of suspected poisoning after eating a box turtle that had been eating mushrooms. Many insects also store toxins to make predators leave them alone. At least one well-known forager does not mention eating insects because of the mushrooms they might eat, and he knows something about mushrooms. In fact, some insects can eat what we consider an edible plant and extract one chemical and build it up until they become unpalatable. So there can be a difference between, well, for lack of better terms, farm-raised insects and free-ranging insects. But let me show you where you can find one of the most common edible insects. Well, actually not an insect, but its larva. Let's call it a grub, which is why this video is G-rated. Oaknuts, or acorns. Well, there they are. These are small ones. About half of all acorns will be infected by an insect larva. Locally, it tends to be the acorn weevil, or the acorn moth. You want the acorn larva. It has no legs, and the moth larva does have legs. Also, the size of the grub can be related to the size of the acorn. Big acorns, big grubs, small acorns, small grub. So, how do you know the difference between an acorn you can use for eating, you know, for flour and all that, and one that hides a grub? Well, you can look at each one individually, or throw them in water. Most of the ones that sink can be used to make acorn flour. Most of those that float have or had a larva inside them. Now we can eat that little larva, raw or cooked, and you can use it for fish bait too. I'll show you how to do that also. There is another method, particularly if you're fishing, and that is you can look for a little single hole like this one here. This tells me that there was at one time at least one acorn grub in here. Now, when the local weevil lays her eggs, she lays several, so there may be other ones in here. Or you may open this up and find that it has a acorn moth caterpillar in here, although you can use both of those for fishing. But the way we find out was we would have to just cut this open and take a look. And before I move on to talk about the grubs, let me show you briefly what I do with the good acorns. I take the good nuts out of their leathery shells, cut off the bad spots if any, and then coarsely grind them. Then they need to be leached with water to get rid of the tannic acid. Now there's a wide variety of ways to do that, but what I did here was I simply ground them up rather coarsely, put them in here, and then I just changed the water morning and night for 4 days. And you can see here the water is getting fairly clear. They're getting to the point where I can use them. The nut meat is not bitter. And I have several options now. I can eat it as it is. I can use a chunky, like mix it with cornmeal and make a muffin. Or I can gently dry it and grind it into a fine powder. Acorn flour is very much like cornstarch. It has a texture like cornstarch. It feels much like cornstarch. And it behaves particularly the same way when you cook it. You can use it to thicken soups. Well, you can if the acorn
Acorns have been processed in cold water. You can learn more about that from my website. Usually he mixes acorn flour 50-50 with some other flour or cornmeal to make various baked goods. Very much, and it actually feels very much like cornstarch as well. If you cook the corn flour with just water, you get a rubbery gel. See that? Which can be used in many ways. It's mild in flavor. As a matter of fact, it tastes very much like egg noodles. It's very nutritious and it keeps well. The most common use is to actually just chop this up and use it as noodles. Yeah. Quite tasty and pretty easy to make. You simply just have to mix the acorn starch and water, bring it to a little bit to a heat and cook it for a while and then pour it into a pan and it will gel by itself. So now that we've got the good acorns taken care of, let's go over and look at the bad acorns and move on to the grubs. My acorns tend to be small and the grubs small, so I just put them in a colander. Twice a day I check for grubs. They crawl out of the shells and start to dig their way down to what they think is the ground. Then they fall at the bottom and I collect them. So this is the luck of the draw. Let's see what we got down there. Oh! Well, there's actually quite a few, but they're kind of hard to tell on this floor, aren't they? Didn't cross my mind. Let's see if I can do something about that. As you can see, there's quite a few of them. That's not a grub. Yeah, whoops, I missed one. Oh, here we go. Yeah, got a hair with it too. Anyway, that was a little easier to see. Well, it's kind of hard to see this. See if we can lower this down just a bit. There are all my grubs. This was totally the luck of the draw. You know, overnight, several grubs have crawled out. And I'll do a close-up in a moment. Now you can pick these up, put them in a bucket of sawdust or a bag of cornmeal or oatmeal, and they'll dig down and make a cocoon. They can stay there in the cocoon from a state of for 1 year or 5 years. Of course, you can take them out and use them for bait almost any time you want. You can have fresh bait year-round if you want, even for ice fishing. You can even store these in the refrigerator. So before they crawl off, here, let me just take a closer look at them. As I said, the grubs can vary in size with the acorn, but what you're looking for is a fat grub with no legs. It tapers towards both ends, got kind of a little brown, a little red head on this end. And as I've said before, it is legless. The moth larva is a caterpillar and it has legs, and you could use that for bait. But for eating purposes, you want this little fellow here. Legless grub, fat in the middle, and a nice little tan color. Look at that. Ollie, leave my grubs alone. Ollie, these are my grubs, they're not yours. Thank you. Gee. You can tell I got grubs here because the cat wants them. Now that you have some grubs, what can you do with them? Well, I have to keep the cat away first. But you can eat them raw. They're surprisingly chewy. But mild in flavor. They're not bitter at all like the acorn. And I suppose I should say this I should cover myself legally and say, this is just for entertainment purposes only. Do not try this at home. Now, although you can eat these raw and they're fine that way, you can also cook them. I prefer frying. They end up actually kind of tasting kind of buttery when you do that. But there is a word of warning. If you drop them into hot oil, they explode almost instantly and disappear. Don't want that to happen. A gentle sauté is best.
The amount of food value with a grub depends upon the size of the grub, and I suppose the grub itself. In Australia, there's such a thing as called witchetty grubs. 10 of those provide all the daily calories and nutrition an adult needs. Eating grubs is something of a rite of passage. You know, once you get past the idea, and then you realize they taste pretty good, kind of buttery to egg yolkish. And when you do that, then you suddenly realize that all kinds of morsels are available. You actually should try them with a little bit of wine. Ah yes, grubs and grog. And that makes sense, doesn't it? If you want to know more about eating grubs and also wild plants, go to my website, eattheweeds.com. In the archives, there's the plant index, and below the plant index, there's an index of other edibles. And so you just follow the plant index down, and you'll see the other ones there, too. Oh, and if you want to get my newsletter, please send me an email address. So until next time, when I return to Just Plants, this is Green Dean saying, I want you to think green, I want you to live green, and eat green too, but sometimes that includes, well, I've got some chives in here, sometimes that includes grubs. Toodles. Oh, yes. No, where's Ollie? Now that they're cooked, he disappears.